यस
सर, देयर वाज वन थिंग सर, इज देयर एनी चांसेस ऑफ यू टेकिंग अ सेकंड क्लास टेस्ट ऑन डायनामिक्स?
I'm quite determined to take the second class test.
सर, फॉर दैट ओनली आई वाज सेइंग, इट इज द नोटिस हैज कम दैट आवर सेकंड थर्ड सेमेस्टर विल स्टार्ट फ्रॉम 23rd August और 24 August. सो इट इज मीन्स इट इज वी अज्यूम दैट आवर सेमेस्टर विल स्टार्ट फ्रॉम अराउंड 11th of August.
Okay.
सो आई एंड आवर वाइवा एंड ऑल आवर एग्जाम्स आर एंडिंग ऑन सेकेंड, देन फोर्थ, देन सिक्स्थ, सिक्स्थ इट इज एंडिंग ऑन सिक्स्थ. सो आई डोंट मीन्स आई देर इज अ वेरी नैरो टाइम पीरियड ऑफ टाइम लिमिट फॉर टेकिंग द एग्जाम. आई वाज सेइंग दैट
आई वांट टू क्लैरिफाई टू थिंग्स. वन, आई कवर द सिलेबस ऑफ योर सिलेबस, ओके, आई मीन बाय द एंड ऑफ दिस मंथ. ओके, सो दैट इज आई बिलीव नेक्स्ट वीक और मे बी नेक्स्ट वीक. ओके, सो होपफुली बाय नेक्स्ट वीक आई विल कवर वट एवर इज रिक्वायर्ड टू कवर इन योर सिलेबस. नंबर टू, as soon as we cover the syllabus, okay, we can have the second class test. Okay, and actually maybe we can leave couple of topics for the semester. So by that, I mean, what I mean by that is, let's say we finish our syllabus by 28th, so we can have the class test by 31st. Okay, so and the class test would be the same way that happened for the last one. So I don't think there should be any problem. Okay, you would be having plenty of time to answer for your class test and but again, I don't think, you know, taking out 2 hours from your quote and unquote busy schedule shouldn't be a problem. Okay, so let's move on to today's discussion. Today we'll be discussing about moments of inertia, and these are different from mass moment of inertia. Okay, and this is strictly we are not looking for. We are looking for area moments of inertia. Okay, and for any given. So it's of course with planar planar sections is what we define our moments of inertia with. Okay, so these are all these sections, these geometries are lying on a plane. So of course it's an open surface bounded by a closed curve, and let's say if we take differential area over here, dA. Typically, this is how we take take dA. So, let's say at any given x, let's say this much is x. You take a differential element, linear element dx, and at any given coordinate y, we would also take a differential increment dy. And with that, you would be having a differential dy dx, and that's the differential area in the Cartesian coordinate. And now we would not be restricting ourselves to Cartesian coordinates, as we have seen with moments, with you know, determination of centroid, and even with Pappas' theorem. So so because of that, I'm just, you know, drawing a general representation of the differential area. And let's say this is the x coordinate of the differential area, and this one is the y coordinate of the differential area. So there are three moments of inertia that you can define, and these are actually quite intuitive because you are already familiar with mass moments of inertia. So for example, we would define the first moment of inertia. So this is called the area moments of inertia. So this one is defined as, can you tell me what should be the expression? So in order to define the moment of inertia about x axis, okay, we should be taking the coordinate of the differential area away from x axis. So basically you should be taking the y coordinate. And this actually is the second moment. Okay. So in order to calculate the centroid, let's say, we would simply take the first moment, integration x dA. So this thing is called the first moment, which means basically whatever quantity with respect to which are you taking the moment has a power of 1. Okay. And in this case, it's the second moment. Which means y or x has a power of 2. So you'd be defining four quantities here. So first one is the moment of inertia about x axis. And for that, you need the distance from x axis, and which would be y in this case. So we basically square that y value and integrate with respect to, integrate over the area. Okay. So the integration is simple. The integration is happening across the area, and the differential that you take is also the differential area. Okay. So for doing this, okay, you don't need any analogy with mass moment of inertia, where it is like a thin plate, okay, with a uniform thickness, okay, and uniform density. And then basically what you do is you get the mass moment of inertia and take away the third dimension and also the density. No, you don't need any of that exercise. I mean, we have done enough of that at the beginning of the centroid class. So by now we should be comfortable with simply integrating with respect to the area. So this is the moment of inertia about x-axis. And similarly, we can define the moment of inertia about y-axis. And it's no brainer that that expression is going to be this. Integration over a x squared dA. Okay. Now, we can define the third moment of inertia represented as J, which is basically moment of inertia about Z axis. Now, can you tell me what should be the expression for that quantity? So when we are getting the moment of inertia about x axis, we take y squared and integrate over area. When you are getting the moment of inertia about y axis, we take x squared and integrate that over the area. So we take the distance from y axis and distance from x axis. If I were to take the moment of inertia about z axis, which is not visible on this planar representation, okay, what is the distance of this differential area from z axis? Can you guess that? You understand the question, right? So to get the moment of inertia about x-axis, you take the distance from x-axis, which is y. To get the moment of inertia about y-axis, you take the distance from y-axis, which is x. To take, imagine the third dimension, which is the z-axis. We have not drawn it. Okay. So to take the distance from z-axis, what should we take? Yes?
Sir, under root of x squared plus y squared.
Yes. So basically we take, yes. So we take this r, that is the distance from z axis. Okay. So we would basically do integration r squared dA, or could also be written as integration x squared plus y squared dA. And because integration and differentiations are linear operations, which basically means I can represent them as the sum of two integrations. So this quantity right here is IYY plus IXX and is known as polar moment of inertia. Why polar? Because I chose to use R. I mean, if R and theta are two coordinates, okay, I'm using one of those coordinates, hence the polar moment of inertia. Now, by now,
I mean, polar moment of inertia means if it was in the place of theta, means we could have replaced that x and y means with respect to r and theta.
No, basically, in polar moment of inertia, we are not measuring the distance from any of the axes. Instead, we are measuring the distance from the origin. That's the difference.
Okay, sir.
Now, by now, you must have decided that whatever we are discussing today is completely worthless and completely useless. Okay, and at least it's not related to mechanics, which might seem correct for, you know, when you are dealing with whatever you have in your syllabus, okay, equilibrium of rigid bodies, so the objects do not deform, and the dynamics of particles, okay. But once you do advanced studies in mechanics, so you come across components like a beam or a column, okay, which tend to bend. So column is the one which takes axial loading, and a beam is one which takes lateral loading, and they tend to bend. Okay, both the column and the beam tend to bend. So this is how the columns bend, and this one I have drawn as something called a fixed free column. So one side it is fixed, the other side it is free. So this is the force P that is being applied. So this is how the column bends, also known as buckling. If you are designing a column, by all means you want to prevent buckling. By all means you'd like to prevent buckling. Okay, if you're designing a beam, the bending of beam is expected, okay, but you still don't want substantial amount of bending, because with bending is associated with your of course the distortion of your structure, okay, and also the quantities known as the stresses and strains, and they may be substantial with the amount of bending, and that could ultimately lead to fracture and failure. Now if you still don't know what are beams and columns, you should look above in whichever room you are sitting. So the components, I mean the slender bodies that are carrying the of course, you know, the houses, each wall and the roof are made of bricks, but the major components are the beams and the columns. So you know, if you have ever seen a building being made, initially there is a mesh of beams and columns, and then the walls are created and also the roof is created. Okay, so in that mesh, this horizontal components which carry loads, because all the loads are due to gravity, all the loads are vertical, so the horizontal components carry loads that are lateral to their orientation, and the vertical components carry the loads that are axial. So these are the columns and these are the beams. Okay, so it is very important for this beams and columns, I mean the study of beams and columns, not just for civil engineering purposes, but for most applications which require any form of application of the mechanical engineering or engineering mechanics. Okay, of course in the current curriculum we don't have this thing involved. Okay, it's because that would be too much for a single semester. But to be frank, as we move further and further in the domains of mechanics, studying of beams and columns become important. And not just beams and columns. What's with beams and columns and moments of inertia? You see, that resistance against deformation. Okay, so in either case, you want to prevent deformation. And of course, here we are not talking about deformation in this subject because we are dealing with rigid bodies or particles. They either don't have dimension, or if they do, there is no change in dimension. But if we do consider the real life objects as deformable, then we would be considering the deformations. And in that advanced study of mechanics, okay, the beams and columns, you know, cover a major part. And actually, the resistance against deformation depends on two things. One is how stiff the material is, also known as the Young's modulus, or the so-called if the Young's modulus were to tend to infinity, the material would actually be rigid. Okay, but it's not. Young's modulus is finite, and therefore the material is not rigid. So it depends on one thing, that is Young's modulus. And then there is another thing that in which on which they depend on, and that is not a material property but a structural property. And that property that you are talking about are different versions of moments of inertia. Okay, so there are two things to so far we know that with respect to stresses and strain, there is a cylinder, you apply axial load F and F, and it just elongates, and that's what is strain, right? Change in dimension per unit length. So that's not the only form of deformation. The structure often bends much easily as compared to axial deformation. And even on axial load, the structure tend to bend or buckle in the lateral direction. And this lateral deformation can be very critical.
Sir, sorry to interrupt, someone to join.
Yes. Yeah. Let them wait, they're already let. So so the lateral deformation becomes critical in with reference to study of deformable bodies. And and actually, if you know this already intuitively, if you take a scale maybe of metal, maybe of plastic, it is much simpler to, you know, bend it with a deformation of 2 centimeters. But you can imagine, even to elongate it by 2 millimeters, it would take an enormous amount of force. Okay, so the point is, we cannot neglect the lateral deformation of the object. And the way you prevent the lateral deformation is by making the moments of inertia sufficiently large. Okay, of course, you cannot make it infinitely large, then the object would be, you know, much heavier and may not suit for the application. But you need to be sufficiently large in order to prevent deformation beyond the tolerance. Okay, so one part there is material property, the other part there is geometric property, and moments of inertia serve as such geometric properties. Okay, so that's why moments of inertia are important. And in addition to these three moments of inertia, I would like to introduce something called a product of inertia. Sorry, actually, product moment of area. So these three quantities are different area moments of inertia, this one being the polar one. Now we would be introducing the product moment of area, which is IXY, and is basically represented like this, XYDA. Okay. Now, I'm not directly going into math. We would do some problems, okay, where we would, you know, look at how you can, you know, try to calculate each of these quantities for a given geometry. The reason I'm not going into the details of the math is because, you know, if you have done enough problems with reference to centroid and you know, Pappus theorem, then you probably have the practice of integrating quantities using double integration or ADI integral. So that can wait a little bit. I want to show you something. You see, the product moment of area has very little application, direct application, when it comes to any determining a geometric property. I'm sorry, not determining a geometric property, when it comes to resisting deformation. But it is crucial, this one is crucial to give you the moment of inertia about different set of axes. For example, if you choose to have a set of axes, let's say this one was x and this one was y, let's call it x prime, and of course at positive 90 degree to x prime is your y prime, and let's say theta is the angle between that's not a very good axis. Okay, so let's discuss what is the purpose of an area moment of product moment of area. So imagine these are your x and y coordinates, and this is the area of which you take a differential area dA. So you get the x and the y coordinates. Now you chose to take a different coordinate system. In this case, that is making an angle of theta, x prime, and this one is y prime, making an angle 90 degree with x prime. Okay, so this angle is also theta. Okay, so to determine, let's say x prime, you'd need quantities like ixx, iyy, ixy, and theta. Okay, and that's where ixy serves the purpose. Now I'll come to the details of this, but before going into that detail, let's discuss something called parallel axis theorem. So imagine these are certain coordinate system x and y, and let's say this right here is a centroid, and you have a different coordinate system x prime, y prime. Now, unlike the previous coordinate system x prime and y prime, the orientation of the axis have not changed. It's only the origin that has been shifted. To where? To the centroid. So this quantity right here is your y bar, and this quantity right here is your x bar. Okay. So now, this is what the parallel axis theorem says, that if x prime and y prime are the coordinates measured from the centroid, or then ix prime is simply ixx minus y bar squared times a, or ixx equals ix prime plus a y bar squared, which basically means the centroidal moment of inertia is the smallest moment of inertia. And if you choose a parallel set of axes, okay, the axes that are parallel to the centroidal axis, then you need to do this correction for the moment of inertia. Now, in the similar way, we can define iyy as y prime plus a x bar squared, and similarly for j, it is simply j prime plus a x bar squared plus y bar squared. And actually, even for product moment of area, you can write it to be I x prime y prime plus a x bar y bar. Okay. Now, I'm just going to show this or prove this for the first one. Okay. Basically, first two are basically the same. I'm just leaving these two as an assignment. Okay. So let's say if I want to represent the coordinates of this differential area dA as x and y, so and imagine this much, sorry, this much is so up to this much is your x prime, that is the coordinate measured from the centroid, and up to this much is your y prime. So basically x is x prime plus x bar and y is y prime plus y bar. Okay, so when I do ixx, it is integration y prime plus y bar whole squared dA. Okay. And I can then use a plus b whole squared formula. So it is y prime squared plus y bar squared plus twice y bar y prime dA. Now y bar is the coordinate of the centroid, so it easily comes out of the integration. So the first term is y prime squared dA. The second term is y bar squared integration dA. And the third term is twice y bar integration y prime dA. Okay. Now, the first term, of course, is your I x prime x prime. In the second term, integration dA is basically a. Now look at the third term right here. You are integrating y with respect to a. So this quantity, only this quantity, this integration becomes y bar prime dA. Sorry, y bar prime times a. Okay. Now, can you tell me what is y bar prime? So y bar is the y coordinate of the centroid as measured from the global axis, or the parallel axis. What is y bar prime?
Sir, is it the area center?
Sorry?
Sir, is it the area center?
What is area center? Area center is centroid, right? That's what you mean, probably.
Okay. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Whatever you mean, I'm not going to relate that to centroid. Okay. So let me tell you this. If I were to do integration y dA, that would be y bar times a, right? So integration y dA is by definition y bar times a, where y bar is the coordinate of the centroid. Or the centroid is defined in such a way that its coordinate is the average y coordinate, right? So that is how the centroid is defined. So when I do integration y dA, that is y bar dA, where y bar is the y coordinate of the centroid measured from the measured from x axis. Now y prime is the coordinate measured from x prime axis. Then y bar prime is the average value of that, which means y bar prime is the y coordinate of the centroid or the distance of the centroid from the x prime axis. So y bar prime is the coordinate of the centroid with respect to the centroidal axis. Or in other words, y bar prime is the distance measured parallel to y axis of what? Of the centroid with respect from what? Of from the centroid. Do you understand what I'm saying? Or rather where I'm going with that? So y bar is the y coordinate of the centroid with respect to the centroid, y bar prime. Then what should be the value of that quantity? I mean, what is your y coordinate in the room that you are sitting with respect to yourself?
So it should be zero.
It should be zero. And that's when you get the desired expression. And that's when you get to write what you love to write, hence proved. I mean, I have seen you write hence proved where in the problem there was nothing to prove. There was, you were supposed to calculate a value. Okay, I mean, not you, but over the years, I've seen people whom I taught. So I guess this is what you love to write, so that you get to do in this case at least. Okay, so so imagine if I am trying to transfer moments of inertia from one set of axis to another, there are two things that I can do. The there are two ways that a couple of coordinate system may differ. One is their origins may be different. The other thing is that their orientation could be different. So the parallel axis theorem takes care of what you need to do if the origin is shifted. Okay, remember, this entire exercise is only valid. This entire exercise is only valid when one of the coordinate systems are centroidal coordinate systems, or one of the set of axes is the centroidal axis. Okay. And the centroidal moments of inertia is the least moments of inertia. I mean, with respect to IXX, IYY, and J. Okay. I cannot say the same about IXY because this might as well be a negative quantity. Okay. I cannot say, I mean, one of the X prime or Y prime could be negative. Okay. I mean, the area itself could be lying on the fourth quadrant. Okay. So I cannot say that IXY is the least IX prime Y prime is the least IXY, that I cannot claim. Okay. So IXY is a signed quantity. Rest of these are unsigned quantities, always positive by definition. They're integrating, you know, something squared. So of course they are positive quantities. And of which the least would be the ones coming from the centroidal axis. Okay. When you take parallel set of axes. Now, let's move on to change of coordinates. Okay. So where the coordinates differ? Yes.
Sir, one thing, sir. While proving, means you showed here that y prime dash is zero. While proving, we will write the position of the centroid with respect to the centroidal axis is zero. We will write that, right? But or the distance of the centroid y-axis of the centroid with respect to the centroid axis is zero. Means actually I was confirming this because in the last CT, means this CT only, while writing the last question answers, means whether the angle should be greater than or less than the equilibrium angle, there was a, means I got very much confused in the English or what to write in that place. So I was just confirming this from beforehand.
স্যারের তো পাওয়ার কাট হয়ে গেছে,
ক্লাসেস
ইয়া, তাহলে আমরা লিভ করছি।
এই কুশাল, আমার না লাস্টের না ওই পার্টটা একটুখানি মানে বুঝতে বুঝতে লেখা হয়নি আমার। লাস্টের ওই পার্টটা হচ্ছে গিয়ে ওয়াই ড্যাশ স্কোয়ার ডিএ ইন্টিগ্রেশন হলে তারপরটা হচ্ছে ওয়াই ড্যাশ ওয়াই প্রাইম স্কোয়ার তার বাইরে ইন্টিগ্রেশন অফ এ ডিএ প্লাস টু ওয়াই প্রাইমটা বাইরে ওয়াই ড্যাশটা ভেতরে ডিএ, তাই তো?
হ্যাঁ এক্স্যাক্ট এক্স্যাক্ট এরিয়া ইন্টিগ্রাল।
তো প্রথমটা থেকে আর নরমালি আসছে হচ্ছে গিয়ে y i x x মানে x প্রাইম প্রাইম, তাই তো?
হ্যাঁ মানে যেটা অ্যাক্সিস পাসিং থ্রু দা সেন্টার অফ
সেন্টার চেঞ্জ চেঞ্জড অ্যাক্সিস।
হ্যাঁ
হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ পয়টা থেকে আসছে হচ্ছে গিয়ে y ড্যাশ y প্রাইম স্কয়ার টোটালটা a, আর তার পয়টা থেকে আসছে হচ্ছে গিয়ে 2 y প্রাইম ড্যাশ a, সরি a না,
মানে ওখান থেকে আমরা পাচ্ছি যেটা বলবি জিরো হবে।
ঝগড়াটা শুনি,
ভালোই তো ঝগড়া হচ্ছে শুনছি।